Hello students, in last lecture we have started unit 1, the genetic material. In this unit we are studying about the evidences for DNA as a genetic material, and in last lecture we have already finished that first experiment, that is Griffith's experiment. Frederick Griffith in 1928 performed this experiment, and he observed that R-type strains of Streptococcus pneumoniae get transformed to S-type strains. He called that something which is responsible for this transformation as a transforming principle or transforming factor. So this experiment we already finished. Today we will study about the second experiment, that is Avery, MacLeod and McCarty experiment, and then we will see about Hershey and Chase experiment. So let's start with first experiment, that is Avery, MacLeod and McCarty experiment. So this experiment, it is performed by these three scientists in 1944, and these three scientists, they discovered that DNA is the substance which is responsible for the transformation of that R-type strain to S-type strains. During that period, many scientists throughout the world, they believed that, they assumed that proteins are actually responsible for the transformation or transmission of characters from one generation to next generation. In such period, these three scientists, they experimentally proved that DNA is actually responsible for the transformation in this Streptococcus pneumoniae, that is nothing but transmission of that character from one generation of this bacteria to another generation. And these three scientists, they published their paper or their findings in the Journal of Experimental Medicine. And the title of their paper was Studies on the Chemical Nature of the Substance Inducing Transformation of Pneumococcal Types, Induction of Transformation by a Deoxyribonucleic Acid Fraction Isolated from Pneumococcus Type 3. And this paper was published in February 1944. Later on, these three scientists, they first kills that pneumococci bacteria, or which is also called as Streptococcus pneumoniae, which is a causative agent of pneumonia. So this Avery first kills this pneumococci with heat, and he extract the saline soluble components from this bacteria. During this experiment, the protein was precipitated by using chloroform, and the polysaccharides which was present in that extract, that was hydrolyzed by using the enzymes. So here, then the active portion of that precipitated was, the active portion was precipitated out by using alcohol fractionation, and which resulting into the formation of fibrous strands which are removed with the help of stirring rod. And the chemical analysis of this active portion shows that the presence of carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen and phosphorus in this active portion, it was similar to the chemical composition of DNA. So later, this scientist, they proved that DNA, rather than other chemical component, that is RNA, protein or different components, is actually responsible for transformation of that R type to S type. And to show this or to prove this, Avery and his colleagues, they use different types of biochemical test. They found that when there is a use of enzyme such as trypsin, chymotrypsin and ribonuclease, which breaks down proteins and RNA, it does not affect transformation process. But when there is a use of another enzyme which breaks down DNA molecule, and the name of that enzyme is deoxyribonucleodepolymerase or deoxyribonuclease, or which is also called as DNase enzyme. So this DNase enzyme, it breaks down DNA molecule and in turn it destroys the extract's ability of transforming that R strain to S strain. So these are the founding of this every MacLeod and McCarty experiment. In next slide we will see how these three scientists, they perform their experiment. So that we are going to see here. See, this is the first slide or test tube here, in which there is a presence of that proteins which are green in color, then DNA which shown blue colored, and RNA which are red in color. So here there is an extract which is obtained from the heat killed S type of Streptococcus pneumoniae, in which that capsule of polysaccharide, it was removed from the solution. And this is the first year in which that test tube consists of these different molecules such as proteins, then DNA and RNA. Here there is no addition of any enzyme. There is no addition of protease enzyme, there is no addition of RNase enzyme, or there is no addition of DNase enzyme. This test tube, it consists of only these three biomolecules, that is DNA, RNA and protein. Now when R strains are added to this test tube, then there is a observation that S cells are present, or that S strains are present here. It means there is transformation takes place. So this tells us that either or whether that DNA, RNA or proteins, all these molecules are present here, and out of these molecules something will be responsible, or some molecules will be responsible for the transformation of these R type cells to S type cells. Then later on, these scientists, they added proteases enzymes in this test tube. So these proteases, they degrade protein molecule present in this mixture, and therefore after degradation of that proteins, now there is presence of only RNA and DNA. So, and when they added these R type cells to this test tube, they again observed that S type cells are present here. That means that transformation process takes place. Now whatever this transformation takes place here, it takes place in absence of the proteins, because that proteins are degraded by using this protease enzymes. So they conclude that RNA or DNA is responsible for transformation. Then in next step, they added another enzyme which is called as ribonuclease enzyme. These ribonucleases, they breaks down RNA, and now there is a presence of DNA or protein here. So there is that green color proteins are here, and that blue color, it is DNA. And when they added these R type cells in this test tube, then they again observe that S cells are present. That means there is transformation takes place. Now in this case, that transformation occurs in absence of RNA. So in here they conclude that proteins are not responsible for transformation, because that was degraded or broken down by that protease enzymes. Here they observe that ribonucleases are not responsible for that transformation, because that RNA, it is degraded by using the ribonuclease enzyme. So only DNA is now remaining here. So to see that whether that DNA is actually responsible for that transformation or not, they perform another test in which they added that deoxyribonuclease enzyme, or which is also called as DNase enzyme. Now this DNA is degrade that DNA molecule, and when they adhere R type cells to this test tube, they observe that there is absence of S strains or there is absence of S type cells. It means there is no occurrence of transformation, and here transformation does not occur without DNA. So from this observation, they concluded that if DNA is not present or if DNA is degraded by that deoxyribonuclease enzyme, then there is no transformation takes place. So from this observation, from this experiment, they concluded that DNA is actually responsible for the transformation of R-type cells to S-type strains. So this is that experiment in which that three scientists, they experimentally proved that DNA was responsible for that transformation from R-type bacteria to S-type bacteria. And therefore, Griffith's transforming principle or transforming factor is nothing but DNA molecule. See, this is another diagram here which also explains that every MacLeod and McCarty experiment here. See, this is the third type 3 S cells in liquid culture medium. Then these are centrifuged, and at the bottom here that type 3 S cells, they are remain collected here. Then when these cells are heat killed by using heat here, and after homogenization of these cells, they recover 3 type S filtrate, and they extract the carbohydrates, lipids, proteins as well as another materials present in that extract here. Now this extract, when it is treated with protease enzyme, so here this protease, now this is the extract which is treated with protease enzyme, and when second R type cells are mixed with this protease treated type 3 S filtrate, then transformation occurs. It means that the proteases, they break down the protease present in that extract, so there is proteins are not responsible for that transformation, and that's why the conclusion is active factor is not protein. Then later on again they treated this mixture with ribonuclease enzyme, and this ribonuclease enzyme, now in which there is an addition of these cells, that is second R cells plus RNAs treated type 3 S filtrate. So that filtrate is treated with RNase enzyme which breaks down RNA molecules present in that extract, and here in this case also that transformation takes place, and therefore that second R cells plus type 3 S cells are present here, and that conclusion is nothing but the active factor is not RNA molecule. Later on, this same mixture, it is treated with another enzyme called as deoxyribonuclease or DNase enzyme. So here that DNase enzyme, it breaks down that DNA molecule present in that extract, and therefore when it is mixed with second R cells plus this filtrate, that is DNase treated type 3 S filtrate, in this case there is no transformation occurs, and only type 2 R cells are obtained here. So the conclusion is active factor is DNA. So how they concluded that the active factor is DNA? Because when DNA is degraded by this DNase enzyme, at that time there is no transformation takes place. It means if DNA is present in functional form, then it can transform that type 2 R cells to type 3 S cells. But here DNA get degraded because of this enzyme, and that's why there is no transformation takes place, and that's why the conclusion is nothing but DNA is the transforming principle. Here this is the control tube here in which that extract which consists of the second R cells plus type 3 S filtrate, transformation takes place, and that second R cells plus type 3 S cells result, because here no any one enzyme is added here. So that's why this is utilized as a control, and in this all these are the filtrates which are treated with different enzymes, And finally, they came to the conclusion that DNA is actually responsible for transformation. So here we completed about the Avery, MacLeod and McCarty experiment. Now next we will see the third experiment, that is Hershey and Chase experiment. So these scientists, they also experimentally proved that DNA is a genetic material in bacteriophages, that is in bacterial viruses. So this Hershey and Chase, they showed that when bacteriophages, which are nothing but the viruses which infect bacteria, and they composed of DNA as a genetic material, and there is also presence of protein molecule. So their DNA molecule enters the host bacterial cell, but protein does not enter in a bacterial cell, it remains outside the bacteria. Alfred Hershey and Martha Chase in 1952, they experimentally proved that DNA is a genetic material in bacteriophages, that is in bacterial viruses. And for this discovery, Hershey shared the 1969 Nobel Prize in Physiology or Medicine with Max Delbruck and Salvador Luria for their discoveries concerning the genetic structure of viruses. So the next slide is of bacteriophage. See, this is the two-dimensional structure of bacteriophage here, and this is the three-dimensional structure of bacteriophage. This is DNA molecule which act as a genetic material in these bacteriophages, and this black color covering, it is nothing but the protein coat. So these bacteriophages, they consist of only two molecules here. One is DNA, which act as a genetic material, and the another one is protein here. Now this portion, it is called as hair of the bacteriophage, this one or this one. Then this is known as this short portion, it is called as collar of the bacteriophage, and this portion, it is called as tail of the bacteriophage, where this portion, it is called as base plate, and these structures, these are called as tail fibers. So this is the simple structure of these bacteriophages, that is two-dimensional structure and three-dimensional structure. So these bacteriophages, they undergoes lytic cycle and lysogenic cycle. So in brief, we will see here what is meant by lytic cycle and what is meant by lysogenic cycle, or how they can undergoes these lytic and lysogenic cycles. See here, in first step, these bacteriophages, they get attached to the surface of this bacterial cell or host cell, and they get attached to this host surface with the help of these tail fibers. Now once they get attached to this host surface, they inject their DNA molecule inside the bacterial cell. So that phage DNA, it enters the host cell or that bacterial cell, but the protein portion of that bacteriophage, now this portion, it is called as ghost of the bacteriophage, which is without DNA molecule. So this portion, it remains outside the bacterial cell. From this stage, these bacteriophages, they either enter into lytic cycle or they enter into lysogenic cycle. So first we will see this lytic cycle here. So this bacterial cell, now having the bacteriophage DNA, so this host DNA molecule, it is digested. When this bacteriophage DNA enters inside the host cell or bacterial cell, then there is a digestion of this host or bacterial DNA takes place, and there is a formation of new phage DNA occurs. So there is a, now here there is a single bacteriophage DNA is here, but in this stage many bacteriophage DNA are formed here. So new phage DNAs are formed, and by using the nucleotides from the former host DNA. So these new DNA molecules are formed here, and these are of fast DNA. Now in next step, this host cell, it transcribe as well as translates these fast DNA molecules, and there is a formation of that fast proteins. So there is a fast proteins are also formed here, and these fast proteins, they get assembled. Therefore new phage is formed here. So whatever that phage DNA and these protein codes are formed here, so they get assembled in next step, and there is a formation of complete new phage. So these phage encoded enzymes, they causes the lysis or breakdown of the cell wall here. So this, there is a synthesis of lysozyme enzyme actually here, and that lysozyme enzyme, it act on the cell wall of this host cell from the inside or from the inner side, and there is a lysis or there is a breakdown of these bacterial cells takes place, and which results into the release of many phage particles. So these new phages are released here, and these new phage particles, they are ready to infect another host cell or another bacteria. So this is called as lytic cycle. Second type of cycle which is undergone by these bacteriophages, it is called as lysogenic cycle. Now in lysogenic cycle, so here this phage DNA, when it enters inside the bacterial cell, later on it get integrated into the host DNA molecule. So this phage DNA molecules, it integrates into the host DNA or bacterial chromosome, and it becomes a non-infective prophage. So this is called as prophage. Then later on, these chromosomes with integrated prophage, it get replicates. So the number of chromosome is increases here, and it can continue through many cell divisions. And in rare cases, this prophage, it gets separated from the host DNA molecule, and then it enters into lytic cycle here. So in this way, that lysogenic cycle takes place. So these are the two cycles of that bacteriophages. One is the lytic cycle, and second one is the lysogenic cycle. So we will see now here how these two scientists, that is Hershey and Chase, they perform their experiment. So we know that every MacLeod and McCarty, they perform that experiment, and they experimentally proved that DNA is a transforming principle in 1944. After 7 years of every MacLeod and McCarty experiment, that is in near about 1951, these two scientists, that is Hershey and Chase, they experimentally proved that DNA is a genetic material, and they performed this experiment on bacteriophages. So this used that bacteriophage, and the name of that bacteriophage is T2 phage, which consists of DNA molecule as a genetic material, and the host for this T2 phage is Escherichia coli. So see this diagram here, which explains how there is a attachment of these bacteriophages to their host takes place, and how there is a release of new phage particles. So in first step here, that bacteriophages, it get attached to the bacterial surface, or that is to the host cell, with the help of their tail fibers. So these bacteriophages, it get attached to this bacterial cell or that host cell. In second step, this bacteriophage, it injects its genetic material, that is DNA, inside the bacterial cell, and the protein portion, it remain outside the host cell or that bacterial cell. Then in third step, some phage genes, they get transcribed by the host RNA polymerase. So this bacterial RNA polymerase, it transcribe some genes of the bacteriophage and get translated to produce the different types of enzymes, which makes the copies of this phage DNA molecule. See here, there are so many copies of that phage DNA molecules are formed. And there are other genes are also there, which get transcribed and translated to form the protein coat or protein capsids of the phage particles. Now here so many these protein coats as well as phage particles are formed here, and all these phage particles and that protein coats, they get assembled here. That DNA or that phage protein coats, they get assembled here, then there is a formation of new phage particles. So number of phage particles are formed here, and another one gene, it get transcribed and translated, and there is a formation of lysozyme enzyme. Now this lysozyme enzyme, it attacks on the peptidoglycan layer of cell wall of this bacteria from the inner side, and this attack of lysozyme on the peptidoglycan layer of this bacterial cell wall, it breaks down, it lyses that bacterial cell wall, and therefore there is a release of large number of phage particles here. So large or many number of phage particles are released here, and these particles, they are now ready to infect the another host cell or new host cell. So in this way, that bacteriophages, they make many copies of themselves. Now this diagram, it explains the Hershey and Chase experiment here. So these scientists, they perform that experiment in two batches. So the first batch is here. Now they mix the radioactively labeled phage particles with bacteria. Now in this first batch, that bacteriophages, they were grown with a radioactive sulfur, that is sulfur 35, and this sulfur, it is present in the amino acids of that protein, and then that is nothing but it get incorporated into the phage protein, now which are pink in color here. So these are the phage proteins here, and that phage proteins, they consist of these radioactive sulfur 35. So later on, now they mix this radioactively labeled bacteriophages with bacteria, and these phages, they infected the bacterial cell, as we have seen in last slide, that is the how these bacteriophages, they get attached to that bacterial cell and how they get multiply. So this is the bacterial cell here, and this black color, it is the DNA of this bacteriophage. So here in second step, now this agitated in a blender to separate phage particles which are present outside the bacteria from the bacterial cells. So this is the empty protein shell here, because that genetic material, that is DNA, now it is entered into the host cell or bacterial cell. So this is the phage DNA molecule here. Then in next step, this bacterial cell, they centrifuge, and the mixture which is obtained, it form a pellet at the bottom of this test tube here. So at the bottom here, that pellet is formed here, that is of bacterial cells and their contents here. But when these two scientists, they measure the radioactive in the pellet and the liquid, at that time the radioactivity was absent here, because it was present in phage protein, because that sulfur is not present in DNA. So that sulfur, it is present in the protein molecule, and that proteins, these are, or that protein coat, it remained outside the bacterial cells, and that's why the radioactivity, it was observed in this protein coat or capsule, or which is called as ghost. It was not present in this DNA molecule which is entered into the bacterial cell. So this is about the first batch, and from this observation, they concluded that the bacteriophages which was labeled with sulfur 35, which get incorporated into the protein molecule, so that protein molecules, they remain outside the bacterial cell, but the phage DNA, it enters inside the bacterial cell. Now in second case, or in second batch, they were grown that bacteriophages with radioactive phosphorus, that is P32, which is present in DNA molecule. So and then later on, it get incorporated into the phage DNA molecule, which shown in blue in color here. So here that DNA molecule now blue in color, because now it is labeled with radioactive phosphorus 32. So this is the DNA molecule here. So when it is agitated in a blender to separate that fast particles, now so this is the bacterial cell in which there is a blue colored DNA molecules are present. Now this blue colored DNA molecule, it is a radiolabeled phosphorus 32 containing DNA molecule, and it is coming from the fast particles here. So here after centrifugation, now that pellets, it gets settled to the bottom, and in this case that radioactivity is shown in fast DNA molecule. So these are the fast DNA molecule here, and that consists of radioactively labeled phosphorus 32. So here again entry of that DNA molecule only, and from this, now when this DNA molecule is entering here, now as we have seen in that lytic cycle, there is a new protein capsids are formed, as well as there is new DNA molecules are formed. That means that DNA is actually responsible for the formation of new fast particles here. So from this experiment, these Hersey and Chase, they concluded that again here that DNA is actually responsible for the formation of new fast particles. That is nothing but they are responsible for the transmission of characters from one generation to next generation here. So in this way, these two scientists, they performed their experiment and they noted all these observations, and they concluded that DNA is a genetic material. So here we completed that first point, that is evidences for DNA as a genetic material. So in next lecture, we will see another point from the same topic. If you have any doubt, then you can comment on YouTube channel or in inbox. And if you have not subscribed this channel, so don't forget to subscribe this channel. So don't forget to subscribe this channel so that you get notified with upcoming videos. Thank you.